For years now, and almost feels like millennia, Connect the World has been bringing you the very latest news concerning Brexit, and we are counting down to the very last second of the do or die talks. The United Kingdom has less than a month to secure a trade deal before crashing out of the EU at the end of the year. Well, how's it going? Well, it depends on who you ask, and we'll get more on that in a moment when we get you to Brussels. First up, though, for as far back as I can remember, things between the UK and continental Europe have been caught up in the nets of the fishermen around the UK and the north of France, believe it or not. So we asked my colleague Anna Stewart to find out her, get her sea legs and head out to untangle this for us.
Fresh fish straight off the boat.
John Dory.
Caught in British waters, but currently subject to EU rules. That could change in the UK's post-Brexit future.
Would you vote in the Brexit referendum?
Definitely.
What do you vote for?
To leave. To leave, definitely to leave.
Why?
For the fishing industry. Why should we supply about 78% of the waters and take about 20% of the catch?
Down the dock, Ike Grantham isn't sure Brexit will make any difference.
Wait. I voted to remain, but now the government's decided to leave, the country's decided to leave, I'm quite happy with that. Let's leave, but let's get the best deal out of it we can. The trouble is, I don't think you're going to get the best deal as a fisherman.
This is Brixham, England's most valuable port, and it voted overwhelmingly for Brexit. The fishermen here want to see fewer European boats in their waters. They also want to catch more fish. Many species are currently restricted under the EU's quota system.
The fishing sector accounts for a tiny fraction of the UK economy, contributing just 0.028% to GDP. And yet, the issue of fishing rights has become one of the biggest hurdles when it comes to the UK and the EU reaching a trade agreement.
It's not just about economics, though. Sovereignty is an emotive issue. These fishermen are out at sea for days or weeks at a time. It can be grueling, dangerous work.
The problem, of course, with speaking to fishermen while they're actually fishing is they're incredibly busy pulling up a big haul of fish. So we're going to try and get hold of them through the wheelhouse with our captain here and see whether we can chat some questions across. This is Anna Stewart from CNN. Hello.
Hello there, yes, Jerry, yes, get with the car helmet. I think it's become a sort of symbol of our independence, of taking back control of our territories and the dreaded common fisheries policy. I've seen the decline of our industry.
A symbol, you say? It's symbolic of Brexit. Is it going to become symbolic of Brexit's failure to take back control?
I've always had my doubts about any sort of deal in Brexit, and I thought we're better off with no deal and getting out, taking all our chips off the table, and then negotiating from a position of strength.
You sound Brexit weary, like many people across the UK. Tell me, I assume you voted for Brexit. Would you do so again?
Definitely, yes.
Its ship has sailed. But trade negotiations are still in play. These fishermen, so far removed from the politics of Westminster and Brussels, hope they're not forgotten. Anna Stewart, CNN, Brixham, England.
Well, let's bring in Philip Lamberts via Skype from Brussels. He's a member of the EU Parliament's UK Coordination Group, which monitors these Brexit negotiations. Good to have you on, sir. EU negotiator, or chief negotiator,
hello,
Michel Barnier in London for talks. Have a listen to what he said earlier to reporters.
Good morning. Important day, determination.
Important day, determination, with less than 4 weeks until the UK is set to leave the EU's orbit. Officials have been saying a deal is imminent. Does that sound right to you?
Well, we are so close, yet so far away, in the sense that I think that 98% of a trade deal has been written down. But the 2% that remains are the most difficult issues to solve. And you mentioned fish. which is not the biggest one of them. The biggest one of them is about level playing field, making sure that if we open the EU internal market to the United Kingdom, we will basically not be faced with unfair competition. And this is what we want to avoid, and this is the most difficult part of the discussion, and there's been no progress at all on that one over the last 4 weeks. So this is ultimately for the Prime Minister to decide. If you want
right, you have market also access. Said that the EU will need to move as well.
Absolutely, and I think that it's obvious that on the fisheries issue, we cannot claim to have the same situation after Brexit than we had before. Most of the fish in the UK waters are fished by EU fishermen, and well, there will be a difference. I mean, it's quite obvious, and I've been saying that also to the fishing communities in my country. You cannot expect to have the same degree of access after than before. And that is something that we will need to accept. Yet, the UK cannot expect the European Union to open its market while having no guarantees about unfair competition. And that is a crucial issue.
That's fascinating. Last month, when Dominic Cummings left Downing Street, he, of course, was the chief of staff, chief spokesman, call it what you will, for Boris Johnson, you said that he was the main reason behind what you described as the UK's tough negotiating stance. And you told the BBC, and I quote you here, it is probably the sign that Johnson has begun his U-turn and will in the end accept EU conditions. Now, have you seen a change in Boris Johnson's negotiating strategy since Dominic Cummings's departure?
Firing Dominic Cummings was a necessary but not sufficient condition. I mean, I think that Dominic Cummings did not want a deal, and that his line was that, okay, the UK will endure the chaos following no-deal Brexit, but it's going to be for the better down the road. Now, he's been fired. It means that an obstacle has been removed, yet it is still for the Prime Minister to decide whether he wants a deal or not. Because anyway, whichever way he goes, he will make people, including in his own camp, unhappy. I mean, no deal means severe disruptions of supply chains for the UK industry, and that will have an adverse economic impact, but a deal will displease significantly the hard Brexiteers. So he will make people unhappy, and you know, Boris Johnson would love to make everyone happy, but that is not possible. And now decision time has come. It's for the Prime Minister to decide whether market access is worth a degree of alignment with EU rules, and if that is not worth it, then there will be no deal.
A bad deal is worse than a no deal, the Conservative government in the UK has said since this Brexit vote back in 2016. Sir, what chance of an extension? Is December the 31st it? I know this is, you know, we're in negotiation at this point, and it's tough times, and it's tough talk. But can you imagine a scenario where this deadline would be extended, given what's been going on with COVID, for example, this last year, making it so much more difficult to get these negotiations done?
Well, as the British Prime Minister, because it is he who asked his parliament to vote a law that forbids an extension. So we have been all for it from the outset, and I would assume that if the United Kingdom would want a form of extension, we would be amenable to it, but at some point in time, a decision has to be taken. Now, if we look at the current legal deadline, it's the 31st of December, and by then, a potential treaty would need to be ratified by then by the House, by the British Parliament and the European Parliament. Now, time is becoming scarce. And therefore, if there's no agreement ratified by then, we might have a period, a limited period of no deal happening. That is, that the EU and the UK would trade on WTO rules, and that would mark a massive difference from the current state of play. Only then to move over to whatever deal would be concluded in between. But there would be chaos in between. And well, I think it's something that we can avoid, but if we can't, we can't. But one thing is certain is that the European Parliament has refused to have a provisional application of a treaty. So just imagine that the UK and the European Union would come to an agreement on the 29th of December. Of course, there would be no time for ratification between that date and the 1st of January. One method would be to provisionally apply all the provisions of the treaty as of January 1st, even though it would not have been ratified by then. But this is an option that has been excluded by the European Parliament, and therefore the alternative, if talks drag on, would be a period of no deal before we get to the future relationship.